You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, welcome to HEA100 Health and Lifestyles at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Today is going to be session 5, and we're going to be discussing weight management and physical fitness. Before we get into that, a couple of announcements for the Young Scholar students. Next week is going to be exam 1. In the syllabus it says how many points and all that fun stuff. So be prepared and watch out for the announcements for when that's available. We're also going to have our second quiz next week. Exam 1 is going to cover weeks 1 through 4. So everything we talked about in our first, second, third, and fourth session will be fair game for the exam. Quiz 2 is specifically going to cover week 2. So generally, as we go through the semester, we're going to have 12 quizzes, and each quiz will cover its specific week. So quiz 1 covered week 1, quiz 3 will cover week 3, etc. Back to exam 1, there's going to be a total of 45 questions, multiple choice and true false, and you're going to have 75 minutes to complete the test. So a couple of quick test taking strategies, and this is going to be relevant for this class, it's going to be relevant for any future classes that you're going to take, is as you're taking the test, be sure to pace yourself correctly. So, you know, don't spend too much time on one question, but on the flip side, don't rush through the whole exam. When you're reading a question, look out for specific keywords that could indicate what answer I'm looking for. So, for example, some keywords could be an absolute statement. So if it's a true-false question and you see an always or a never in the question, that's a good indication that the question is false. On the other side of test-taking strategies, you should also begin to develop or continue to develop your study habits. Everyone studies a little bit differently, and one of the goals of this class is to get you to kind of recognize your best study habits or the best ways that you can study. Now, some people it takes a little bit longer than others to figure that out, and that's perfectly fine. But, you know, it's important to try new things. You know, maybe one day you study at home, maybe another day you study at a library, and then you kind of play around with it and see what works for you. So that's really important. Some people, you know, they'll get halfway through college before they realize, oh, I actually need to study a different way, and then grades change, they do much better, you know, everyone has better time. So test-taking strategies, pace yourself through the test, look for keywords in the questions, and appropriate study skills. Studying in front of the television is not an appropriate study skill, and it's probably not going to work for you. So on to today's lecture. As always, we're being broadcast live, so if you have any questions or comments at any time during the lecture, please feel free to call in. If you don't want to call in, you can also write in, and I'll read the question out loud on camera. For the Young Scholar students, again, you will receive a point of extra credit for writing in a question. So today we're going to specifically discuss physical fitness and health-related components of fitness. We're going to explain the wellness benefits of physical activity and exercise and describe healthy levels of body fat and what's involved in body fat regulation. So before we get in specifically to physical fitness, I want to quickly finish last week's lecture. We left off talking about proteins, carbohydrates, and fats, and there's a few other components of a healthy diet that need to be mentioned. Specifically, we have vitamins, and vitamins are organic substances required in small amounts. Humans need 13 vitamins to survive. Some of them will only be produced in other foods. Humans can produce 2 vitamins ourselves, vitamin D and vitamin K. Vitamin D is produced in the skin when it reacts to ultraviolet light, and vitamin K is produced in the liver. All the other vitamins that we need to survive can only come from food. So I want to talk quickly about supplements. We're going to talk a little bit more about these in greater detail later on in the lecture, but specifically for right now, you shouldn't need supplements in order to get the proper amount of vitamins that you need to survive. Everything your body needs should come from the food you eat. And we have a clip to show you from a Colbert Report about vitamin water and other foods and drinks that are labeled as healthy. And as you watch this, keep in mind that just because something says it's healthy doesn't mean it's healthy. And really, the vitamins that your body needs, you should be getting from food, not from a drink, not from a pill, not from whatever wacky fad is going on right now. So let's watch the video. Keep in mind what's happening. What are these advertisers trying to do? What is this product trying to accomplish? And what do we actually need to do in order to remain healthy?
Thank you for rejoining our like a mother tigress to their defense if anyone attacks them. I am especially protective.
Technical difficulty there. We'll sort that out and see if we can go back to it in a little bit, but I'll continue talking about vitamins. So basically what the clip was gonna say is drinks like vitamin water. They say it's healthy, they say it requires all the vitamins that your body needs, but it really doesn't. It's essentially sugar water. The clip is now ready, so let's go to it.
Thank you for rejoining our like a mother tigress to their defense if anyone attacks them. I am especially protected.
We're having some problems with the Colbert Report website. So anyway, back to the vitamins. So watch out for specific labels. So if you see an energy bar that says, oh, all the vitamins that you need to survive, that's probably not gonna be healthy. Your body has been designed, it's evolved to get their vitamins from fruits, vegetables, from protein, various protein sources, you know, from the water you drink, from the sunlight that hits our skin. So just taking a pill or drinking a vitamin water does not make you healthy. There's a couple of exceptions to that rule. If you've been prescribed supplements by a physician, then that's an exception. Usually women will need calcium pills as they enter menopause because it'll destroy the calcium in their bones. So general things like that. But for the most part, steer clear of supplements. For vitamin deficiencies, sometimes your body will lack a vitamin and it'll present a specific set of signs and symptoms for that. So for example, if you lack vitamin C, you can develop scurvy. Children who do not have enough vitamin D develop rickets, and a vitamin A deficiency can lead to blindness. Generally, you can get vitamin A from your food sources, so eat a carrot every once in a while and that's all you need. Vitamin D, all we recommend is 15 minutes out in the sun a day, and that's plenty of vitamin D. You know, you don't go to a tanning salon because that's not the same as sunlight and it can actually be very bad for your skin. So 15 minutes in the sun a day, you may get tan, you may not, but it's a healthy level of ultraviolet light that will spur the production of vitamin D. So let's move on to making the informed choices about the foods we eat. Generally, you should consult with a physician, like I said, to see if you even need to take supplements. Sometimes you may, but most of the time, you absolutely don't. So let's talk about what's in a healthy diet. Generally, we say balance your calories. So what does that mean? Don't eat more calories than you burn through in a day. So if you only burn 1,500 calories a day, and you're eating 2,000 calories a day, you're going to gain weight. Many Americans are overweight because they eat high-calorie foods without the prerequisite physical activity to burn them off. So they'll go to McDonald's, they'll go to In-N-Out, they'll eat, you know, Double Double or Big Mac, and several thousand calories in each meal, and then they're not running afterwards, or they're not jogging, or they're not doing the proper physical activity necessary to burn those calories. It's essentially like putting fuel in a car that doesn't need it. But for human bodies, what the body will say is, oh, look, we're getting extra food, better store that away for later, and then that's how fat deposits develop. So food components to reduce, we like to say, reduce your salt intake, less than 2,300 milligrams of salt a day. A lot of people don't realize, but there is a lot of salt in a lot of foods. If you ever buy frozen foods from a supermarket, there is a ton of salt in there just because it helps preservative and it enhances the taste and flavor. Same with fast foods. There is an immense amount of salt in the fast foods that we eat. We don't realize this, of course, but it's actually very bad for our bodies. And over time, over 20, 30, 40 years, it can lead to severe kidney disease. Also limit saturated fats and trans fats. We talked about those in session 4. Trans fats, saturated fats, come mainly from fried foods. So these are the McDonald's chicken nuggets. These are the In-N-Out double-double. Reduced calories from added sugars, so essentially sodas. Humans evolved loving sweet things. Like our primary diet as we, 200,000 years ago was fruits, vegetables with the occasional protein source. So we like sweet things. So when we eat something that's super sweet, such as a soda or a candy bar, our brains, the lights turn on and the brain goes, oh, this must be very nutritious. I like sweet things. Let's keep eating it. So it's kind of tricking us into thinking that we need it, but we don't. So just be very careful of added sugars. And limit refined grains. So these are things like white bread. If you like bread, awesome. Whole wheat, whole grains is the way to go. And what to increase? Obviously, fruits and vegetables. About half of your plate should be fruits and vegetables. Increase whole grains. Milk, if you drink milk, it should be fat-free or low-fat. Whole milk is usually too much high of a fat content for us. And eat a variety of proteins, fish, poultry, eggs, beans, and limit red meat. For the vegetarians out there, we talked about this last class as well, you have to be sure to maximize your protein intake because there's no one source of protein like a hamburger or a steak that you can eat to survive. So you'll need a variety of beans and legumes and nuts and walnuts and fish if you eat fish to complement a healthy diet. And I also wanted to quickly touch on organic foods. Organic foods are not necessarily healthier than non-organic foods. The only main difference between the two is that organic foods have a limited use of pesticides on them. So in order for foods to be labeled organic, they have to meet very strict federal regulations, usually dealing with farming practices and pesticide use. So organic farms are usually a little more sustainable, they're usually a little better for the environment, and they usually don't use pesticides. So that's the big difference between that and non-organic foods. Non-organic foods are usually from the big industrial farms. The farming practices may not be necessarily as sustainable because they're going for higher yields, and they will use an extreme amount of pesticides. So while it's not any healthier for you, organic food can be slightly more expensive. So if you're budget conscious, what we like to do is watch out for specific foods because those will have an extra amount of pesticides in them. So the list is, and there's a long list, it's apples, bell peppers, celery, cherries, grapes, nectarines, peaches, pears, potatoes, raspberries, spinach, and strawberries. Now, due to the nature of these specific fruits, they'll absorb and trap pesticides in them easier than other fruits. So if you want to go organic, those are the primary foods that you should switch over to organic foods. There's also a difference between organic food and genetically modified food. In the media, usually there's a big hoopla about GMOs and how it's unnatural or how it's actually more dangerous for us than non-genetically modified foods. That's not necessarily the case. Genetically modified food means that they inserted a gene into the plant that otherwise wouldn't have been there in order to make it do something. So generally, GMO foods they'll grow a little bit bigger, they'll require maybe a little bit less water, and they'll be resistant to certain pesticides, or they'll actually produce the pesticides themselves. Now, there's nothing necessarily wrong with that. It's not unnatural. People have been genetically modifying food since we first learned how to plant food. So over the past 12,000 years, people have been genetically modifying food. We just did it a different way. Instead of doing it in the lab, we'd crossbreed plants back and forth until we got what we wanted. There's not that big of a difference between the two. But generally, it's if you're concerned about pesticide use, you would switch to organic foods. But in and of itself, genetically modified foods isn't bad for you. It's not going to hurt you. It won't cause cancer. It won't cause brain tumors. It won't cause autism. There's a big list of what people think will happen, and generally nothing bad will happen. A really great example of a positive genetically modified food is called golden rice. And remember I said a little earlier that a vitamin A deficiency will cause blindness in children? In Southeast Asian countries, the primary diet is rice, and rice does not contain any vitamin A. So what would happen is the parents would feed their kids this staple, rice, and they wouldn't have access to fresh fruits and vegetables. So the children were going blind for lack of vitamin A. So what researchers were able to do is insert a gene into rice that allowed it to produce vitamin A. So this never would have happened naturally. It was a one in a million chance that a mutation like that could have occurred. But they artificially inserted a vitamin A gene into the rice, and lo and behold, the kids stopped going blind because they were getting vitamin A. So in cases like that, you know, genetically modified food is perfectly fine, especially if it can help us, you know, feed more people, the health of the population would increase, and that's okay. Back to organic, experts also recommend buying organic meat, dairy, poultry, eggs, and baby food. And that's specifically, again, for humane reasons or the way that poultry and beef are raised in this country. So organic beef would more likely to be free range, to be grass fed, as opposed to non-organic beef, which would be, you know, in a stock and be force-fed food, or it'd be fed very unhealthy foods with a high amount of antibiotics in them. So that's basically it for our nutrition lecture. Again, if you have any comments or questions, feel free to write in or call in. And with that, we're going to move on to physical fitness. So what is physical fitness? Physical fitness is a set of physical attributes that allow the body to respond or adapt to the demands and stress of physical effort. So generally, there are various components of fitness made up of cardiorespiratory endurance, muscular strength, endurance, flexibility, and body composition. So let's go through each one and kind of discuss each one and how that leads to overall healthier lifestyles. So cardiorespiratory endurance is the ability to perform prolonged, long muscle dynamic exercise at moderate to high intensity. When cardio fitness is low, so when people don't exercise regularly, the heart has to work hard during normal daily activities and may not be able to work hard enough to sustain a high level of physical activity. Poor cardio fitness is linked with heart disease, diabetes, colon cancer, stroke, depression, anxiety, and premature death. So it is incredibly important for us to be active, for us to get up and go and move around. Generally, if you walk up one flight of stairs and your heart's beating and you're sweating and you're out of breath, that might be a good indication that you need to exercise a little bit more. You need to increase your cardiorespiratory endurance. So endurance training will make the heart stronger and improve function of the entire circulatory system. How this works is the heart pumps more blood per heartbeat. Resting heart rate slows and blood pressure decreases, and blood supply to tissues improves and metabolic health improves. A healthier heart can help withstand the strains of daily life, stress of occasional emergencies, and the wear and tear of time. Now, as you know, young adults, we think everything is going to work fine forever, but that's not true. Remember, one of the big overall themes of this class is what you do today, or what you do as a young adult, is going to lay the foundation for later in life. It's going to determine how healthy you are later in life. So if you don't exercise now, or if you don't start exercising now, you're going to turn 50, 60, and all of a sudden your heart's not going to work as well anymore. It's not going to be able to pump as hard. You're not going to be able to move around as much just because you're physically limited now by your heart. So it's very important. You eat healthy, you exercise regularly, and you keep your heart health high. So later in life, when you're 50, 60, 70, you know, you're still active. You can still move around. You're not having any problems, and you won't need surgery. So how can you develop cardiorespiratory endurance? Very easily, actually. We have a video coming up that's a really good indicator of what's necessary for cardiorespiratory endurance. Before we watch it, I'll give my definition. Basically, it's just performing activities that involve rhythmic movements of large muscle groups, such as the legs. So these activities can be jogging, cycling, dancing, you know, an exercise class, something like that. Anything really that gets the blood pumping and the heart beating is cardiorespiratory endurance. So let's go to the video. And this video is essentially showing how easy it is to exercise and the benefits of exercise. So while we're watching it, watch for key phrases. Watch for what they're actually doing. Are they're jogging, they're exercising. What is involved in the healthy lifestyle? So let's go to the video.
It's time for Buffed, Beautiful, and Bitchin', the at-home workout with Vera DeMilo.
Hi, I'm Vera DeMilo, and thanks for tuning in. You know, before I learned how to exercise properly, I was a poor excuse for a woman. Just look at those unsightly lumps of lard protruding from my sternum. I was so weak and frail back then, I couldn't even tear a telephone book in half. But I made that change, and you can too. So let's get busy burning off those bothersome bazoons. Girls, are you ready? All righty. Let's start with a stretch. And deck. Okay, now you try. See how those big breaths just weigh them down? I'm telling you, you can't float till you get rid of those sinkers. And now the shoulder. Come on, girls. Oh, yeah. That's right. Uh-huh. That's right. Now this one. Just pull it. And pull it. Really pull it. Wow. That's gonna be sore in the morning. But it hurts so good. And you know what they say. No pain, no gain. Now, before attempting any serious lifting, I can't stress enough the importance of eating a healthy breakfast. Of course, I prefer mine in concentrated form. Another advantage of my at-home workout is that there's no need for investing in costly weight sets. With just a little imagination, a few hefty household appliances will do just as well. Deidre, the secret to a strong, flat championship chest is breast bombardment with maximum weight. Are you ready? All righty. That's the spirit. Show those memories no mercy. Hey, kids. It's time for Vera's vanity table. You know, some women spend a lot of money on lipsticks and glosses to make their lips look fuller. I say you can get the same effect naturally with a nice hot curling iron. Watch. Of course, it helps to have a high pain threshold. But believe me, when these babies start to blister, look out, Michelle Pfeiffer. Till next time, TV.
All right, so that clip, I think, really illustrated physical fitness in a lot of its different forms. So remember, it's not just cardio respiratory fitness, which the video illustrated through the stretching, through the rhythmic movement of muscles. It's also muscular strength, which the video illustrated through the weightlifting. Also showed a bit about supplements, how, you know, pretty good reason not to take supplements because you're going to look like him. And also is going to talk about body image, which we'll get to in a little bit. So cardiorespiratory endurance, to sum up, can be any movement, any rhythmic movement of muscles that increases heart rate. So jogging, walking, the exercise routines. and things of that nature. So the other thing that the video clip talked about was muscular strength. So when he was lifting the washing machines up. So muscular strength is the amount of force a muscle can produce with a single maximum effort. So the more muscle mass you have actually means better metabolism. But you don't need to be a bodybuilder to have good muscle strength. Generally, strong muscles are important for everyday activities such as climbing stairs or, you know, fighting off bears. You don't need to be toned in order to have good muscular strength. What we like to say is, and everyone's different, so some people, you know, some people like working out a lot, some people don't, and that's perfectly fine. What we like to say is whatever muscular strength you have that allows you to perform your normal daily activities relatively easily is the perfect amount for you. I know some people like going a little bit above and beyond, and that's fine, but it's not necessary to live a healthy lifestyle. And we'll talk about this later on with body image, but you know, being really ripped, having intense muscle tone, that's not necessary for a healthy lifestyle. Just general weight training, general high or moderate intensity muscular activity is all one really needs in order to be healthy, in order to stay healthy throughout life. Muscular strength also helps keep the spine in alignment, prevent back and leg pain, and promotes good posture. It can help maintain muscle mass, function, and balance in older people as well. So this is actually specifically important for older Americans as they get into 60s, 70s. You don't think about it when you're younger, but your balance starts to kind of fade. So you're not necessarily able to, you know, run as fast or walk as fast because you're very worried that you're going to fall over or trip. And if you fall and break a bone, especially at an older age, it can actually be very deadly. So proper muscular management now can lead to healthier lifestyle later on. Muscular endurance, which is slightly different than muscular strength, is the ability to hold a muscle contraction for a long time or contract a muscle over and over again. So we have a video, it's an example of someone using weight training. So while we're watching the video, what's going on? Are they using muscular strength? Are they training muscular endurance? Look at the keywords going on in this clip. You know, where are they going? What's happening? And you know, the clip is going to show, you know, a before and after. So over the long term, you know, what happened to the character? So let's go to the video.
Game? What's a game? Oh, a game. Oh, boy, I'm feeling this. Oh, ooh, my head's gonna be sore in the morning. Oh.
Excuse me, you're doing the stay snort backwards. Let me show you how to do it like a man.
Rainier Wolfcastle. Oh, I love your movies and your power sauce bars and your taut ribbon.
Hey, that's enough. Now step over to the Abdominator, and I will shout slogans at you. Push harder. Go past the max. Reach over the top. Master your ass.
Wow, Wolfie. 2 months ago, I didn't know what the word dumbbell meant. This place is great.
So that's a great example of muscular strength, right? He's building muscle, he's training muscle over the long term. Muscular endurance, like I said, the ability to hold a muscle contraction for a long time, that's an example of stretching, yoga, lifting, things like that. So anything that moves your muscles around, causes you to contract your muscles for an extended period of time is muscular endurance. So stretching muscles with a greater demand than they are used to develops muscular endurance as well as muscular strength. But it's really important to know your limits. And I'm gonna answer a question from Julianne that kind of ties into this. She writes, how do you know what a good amount of exercise is for you? And how do you know if it's too much or not enough? So everyone's different, obviously. So everyone's gonna have a little bit of a different starting base for what's a good amount of exercise. So what we like to say is 30 minutes of moderate physical activity a day is generally all you need. Now, it depends on, you know, your weight or your health level. Some people should use a little less, some people maybe a little more. But generally, for, you know, the average American, 30 minutes a day of moderate activity. Moderate activity, and I think we'll get to this in a little bit, is defined as breaking a sweat and increasing breathing and heart rate. Not a lot, and so you're not out of breath, but you know, you get the heart pumping, you may be sweating a little bit. So that's moderate physical activity, and that can be anything from, you know, walking around the block to, you know, maybe running a little bit depending on your endurance level, and maybe even taking, you know, an aerobics class. So everyone's a little different, obviously, and the only way to figure it out is to actually start exercising. So, you know, you can pick a baseline and just try it for a couple of days. So, for example, you can say, all right, I'm going to walk half a mile today and I'll see how I feel after. So you can start walking that half a mile, and, you know, if you get to where you're going and back to where you started and, you know, you're not really breathing heavily or you're not really sweating that much, then you may want to increase your activity level. You may want to go a mile, or, you know, maybe three quarters of a mile, something like that. But if, you know, you're walking that half a mile and, you know, maybe you get a couple of blocks and your chest is hurting, and, you know, your heart's beating, and you're really sweating, that means you need to tone it down a little bit. And you need to start smaller and then work your way up. So it's important to not overdo it. So how do you know if it's too much or not enough? It's generally the way you feel. And your body has a really great way of telling you when enough is enough. So you probably all have heard the old saying, you know, no pain, no gain. And it's partially true. So if you're pushing yourself so much that you're actually in physical pain, then you probably are doing too much. What you want to do is push yourself a little bit beyond your comfort level, because that's how you build stamina, that's how you build muscle. But pushing yourself so much that, you know, you're vomiting, or you have your arms and legs and joints ache the next day, that's probably a little bit too much and you want to cut it back. So everyone's a little different, and there's no checklist about what you need to look for or what you need to do in order. It's just kind of, you have to play around with it. You know, if you walk that half a mile and you feel great the next day, you know, do a half a mile again for a couple more days and then increase it to a mile and see how you feel. If you walk a half a mile and the next day, you know, if you feel terrible and your chest hurts and your arms hurt and your legs hurt, you may want to cut it back a little bit for a while and then build up to a half a mile. So it's all about finding that right balance and then pushing yourself just a little bit farther in order to build up endurance or muscle or cardiorespiratory endurance. So let's move on now to another aspect of physical fitness is flexibility. So flexibility is the ability of joints to move through their full range of motion. Age and inactivity can cause joints to become stiff. So a stiff joint, if you've been, you know, sitting on the couch all day and you go to stand up and, you know, you feel it in your hip and it kind of hurts a little bit for a second, or, you know, you're a little stiff in your knees, that's what we mean by flexibility. And it's not that difficult to increase someone's flexibility. You can, you know, yoga, just general stretching. What we like to say is a solid, you know, 5 to 10 minutes of light stretching a day is all you need. You know, you stretch your arms a little bit, you stretch your legs a little bit, just to kind of, you know, ease out the muscles. And we really recommend people stretch before and after any sort of moderate or vigorous exercise. So if you're going for a walk for a mile or half a mile, you know, stretch for a little bit beforehand, and then, you know, go for your walk or run, and then stretch again when you get back home or wherever. And so that's generally the overall aspects of physical activity. We also have one slight, you know, tangent to that, which is body composition. And that refers to the proportion of fat and fat-free mass in the body. Healthy body composition is made up of a low level of body fat and a moderate to high level of muscle. And remember, when we say muscle, I don't mean someone who's ripped. I don't mean a bodybuilder. I don't mean, you know, Arnold Schwarzenegger when he was 25 years old. I mean, you know, muscle that's suitable for your everyday activities. A person with excess body fat, and this is something to really watch out for, especially as we age, especially in the abdomen, is more likely to experience health problems such as heart disease, high blood pressure, stroke, joint problems, diabetes, cancer, and back pain. So an interesting thing about abdomen fat is that men will tend to store fat in the abdomen more than women will. So as we just heard, all the risk factors for that, men will have a higher risk for heart disease, diabetes, and things of that nature. So it's very important to exercise regularly and keep off excess body fat. So how do you do that? Best way to do it, plenty of exercise and a very healthy diet. Remember though, and we'll get into this again in when we talk about body image, but women tend to have more body fat than men. So a lot of times when, you know, couples or friends are exercising together, you know, men will start to lose weight a little bit faster than women. And women shouldn't be discouraged with that. They just are going to have, at baseline, a higher percentage of body fat than men. And that has to do with, mainly it has to do with child rearing. You need that for breast milk. But, and it's okay, you know, thin isn't the overall goal. Health is the overall goal. You know, you shouldn't be eating healthy and exercising to be a supermodel thin. You should be eating healthy and exercising regularly to be healthy. So healthy really depends on the person. You know, it goes back to what the appropriate level of exercise is for you. It's different for everyone. Some people are going to be a little bit on the thin side. Some people are going to be a little bit on the bigger side. Some people are going to be somewhere in the middle. And all of that is perfectly fine. As long as you're exercising regularly, as long as you're eating healthy, it doesn't matter if you're, you know, a couple of pounds heavier than you want to be. You're still healthy. And there's no health downside to that. So now that we just talked about physical fitness, let's get into physical activity, which is slightly different. So all physical fitness is comprised of physical activity, but physical activity, the definition is any body movement carried out by skeletal muscles that require energy. And skeletal muscles are, you know, the muscles that we move around. So our biceps, our triceps, our leg muscles, our calf muscles, all those are skeletal muscles. So physical activity is any movement that carried out by skeletal muscles that require energy. So that's a very broad definition, and that's what we try to, what we're trying to convey in this class, is that physical activity isn't going to the gym. It's not, you know, running on a treadmill for a couple hours. It's, you know, gardening. It's, you know, scrubbing the floor. It's vacuuming. It's walking up a flight of stairs. It's parking as far away as you safely can from your work or school and then walking in the rest of the way instead of parking as close as you can. It's just generally about increasing your movements, increasing your activity level. And exercise, so specifically exercise, this is a subset of physical activity. It refers to planned, structured, repetitive movement of the body intended specifically to improve or maintain physical fitness. So moderate intensity activity is essential to health and confers a wide range of health benefits. So exercise, as opposed to just general physical activity, exercise is when you go to the gym. Physical activity is when you walk up the stairs, you walk across the parking lot, you do the dishes, you vacuum, things like that. So back to the exercise guidelines, this goes back to the question that was just asked. We recommend, and this is on a week, adults should do at least 2.5 hours a week of moderate aerobic exercise. And that breaks down to about 20 to 30 minutes a day of moderate exercise. Or you can substitute that for 75 minutes a week of vigorous intensity activity. Or you could do some intricate combination of the two. So the general idea is, you know, to get up and start moving. So moderate activity is, you know, you start sweating, your heart starts beating, you know, you start to breathe heavier. Vigorous activity would be your heart is beating heavily and you're panting and out of breath. So that would be vigorous activity. We also recommend that adults should do moderate muscle strengthening activities for 2 hours a week. So moderate muscle strengthening activities, you know, you don't need to go to a gym to do that. It could be, you know, lifting up a sack of dirt when you're gardening. It could be lifting up a sack of potatoes. It could be any wide range of activities. As long as you're, you know, working your muscles and building it, then that's perfectly healthy. And these levels of physical activity, like everything else, promotes wellness by lowering the risk of high blood pressure, stroke, heart disease, type 2 diabetes, colon cancer, osteoporosis, and reducing mild feelings of depression. So there's huge benefit to regular physical activity. So Alexander writes, what is the reason that men store body fat in the abdomen more than women? That is just a sex difference. I don't know the biochemical reactions behind that or the biochemical pathways behind that, but I believe it is mainly due to, well, women will store fat tissue in the breasts and in the butt, and guys store fat tissue in the abdomen. And that's just a sex difference. I really actually don't know. Yeah, I don't know the biochemical reactions behind that. I do know women store fat tissue in breasts for breastfeeding their children. So human milk has a fairly moderate to high fat content that's necessary for healthy babies. It doesn't mean to say that women with low breast fat don't provide adequate milk, but generally that's the reason behind that. So we'll go back to moderate and vigorous physical activity. Moderate, again, any activity that causes notable increase in heart rate. Vigorous, any activity that causes rapid breathing and substantial increase in heart rate. So vigorous activity would be like running on the treadmill back there, or running a couple of miles nonstop. So when you're done, you're breathing heavily, your heart's beating, you're sweating, that's vigorous. So now we have a pretty good example of vigorous activity. In this video clip, watch for what the main character is doing. Keep in mind the recommendations for physical activity and what I was saying about, everyone's a little bit different, so you need to start off based on what you can do. So in this video clip, watch, is he exercising too much? Is he exercising not enough? So what's going on and how does that relate to health? So let's go to the video.
What's your dad's job again?
He's a nuclear safety technician.
What's he doing with that broom?
What isn't he doing?
I heard that guy's ass has its own congressman.
Hey, leave my dad alone. Just because he's overweight doesn't mean he's bad. He's a sweet man and he has real feelings.
Hey, what are you kids looking at?
Hey, look! He's trying to get up to yell at us!
Oh, don't make me close that shade!
Sorry, so that was a clip that I was supposed to show a little earlier. That's an example of avoiding physical inactivity. So what we like to say, remember, moderate to vigorous activity every day for the whole week. So that's a really great example of what happens in activity and an example of inactivity itself. So Homer, instead of getting up, walking to the window, he was sitting at the couch kind of, lazily shooing people away. So that's an example of what a physical activity and that what can lead to health problems down the road. So all he would have to do just a little bit to be a little healthier is to get up, walk around, move around a little bit more, and he would have been healthy. That would have been perfectly fine physical activity. So now let's go to the next video, and this is going to be the example of vigorous physical activity. So when you're watching this video, watch out for what is the main character doing. Is this vigorous activity? Is this moderate activity? Should he be doing this vigorous activity or moderate activity? Should he be starting a little slower, working his way up? Is he a victim of physical inactivity? So let's go to that video.
Motivate you people. He's been down in the locker room scarfing down chocolate-covered coffee beans for the last 6 hours. I think he's ready. Hey, Matt, we're ready for you.
Okie dokie. Oh. All right, how you guys doing? Okie dokie, my name, for all of you don't know me, is Matt Foley. And I am a motivational speaker. Now, before we get to the spinning class, let me give you a little bit of a scenario of what my life is all about. First off, I am 35 years old. I am thrice divorced. And I live in a van down by the river.
You're gonna be our fitness instructor?
Listen, hard body, I don't give a rat's behind. I'm here to tell you people that as you get out there in the real world, you're gonna find out that you're not going to amount to jack squat. Now, fella, Young man, what do you want to do with your life?
What do I want to do?
Yeah.
I'm a successful corporate lawyer. I just made partner.
Well, la-di frickin' duh! Hey, Evan, We got ourselves a lawyer over there. Mm. I can't real see real good. Is that Ben Matlock?
No, Matt, he's a real lawyer.
Evan, You know, I wish you could just shut your big yapper! Please!
Okay.
If you're as good a lawyer as you are an athlete, you're gonna be doing a lot of lawyer practicing in a van down by the river.
I own a summer home near the river, if that helps.
Shift it into loan, Matlock. Well, let's get started. Okay, first thing that you're gonna wanna do is to get settled into the saddle. Okay. Now, you'll often find that when mounting the apparatus, you'll split your shorts. It's a common occurrence. Stay motivated. Do not let it get you. Because as long as you're wearing an athletic supporter, everything's going to be okie-dokie. However, I've forgotten mine is kind of a moot point.
Gross. Oh. You cannot be serious.
God. I just wish you two dolls would bring it down a notch.
Now that you're on the bike, next thing you're gonna wanna do is take a little bit of a rest. You know what I mean? Just catch your breath a little bit, make sure you still got your bearings. You'll find that just getting on the bike is gonna make you weak. Okay, let's start pedaling, everybody. Now, a nice brisk pace to start out with. Okay, not that brisk. Okay, a little less brisk. Low on the brisk, go slow now. Slow it down here, okay? Stop
right here.
Okay, now it's time to take a little bit of a drink, ski-poo. So.
All right, so that was a great example of physical activity and specifically exercise. So what they were doing on the bicycles, you know, it was repetitive movement with the intention of promoting health, so that was exercise. And that was a great example of also what not to do. So if you're someone in Chris Farley's position, you know, where you're pretty overweight, you shouldn't, and you're just getting tired from getting on the bicycle, you know, that's an example of, you know, listening to your body and toning it down a little bit. So maybe for him, his physical activity for a couple of days would be just getting on the bicycle. And then over time, he starts building that up and he starts riding a little bit. And then over time, he becomes much more healthy. That's also an example of what's supposed to happen in vigorous activity. So a spinning class would be considered vigorous activity. You know, you're sitting there, you're pedaling there for a half an hour, working up this huge sweat, you're out of breath, your heart's beating. So that's vigorous activity. Back to the other question that said, you know, how do you know when you're overdoing it? Well, if you're pedaling on that bike and, you know, you're starting to feel nauseous or you're starting to get in pain, then that's when it's a good indication to stop. So just, you know, listen to your body. Everyone's a little bit different. So, you know, if you're exercising with a friend and, you know, you feel, you know, a little sick, you feel a little in pain, you want to stop and they're perfectly fine to keep going, you know, that's okay. Everyone's a little bit different and everyone has a little bit of a different starting out baseline. So, you know, just push yourself a little, but be very wary and, you know, don't overdo anything. You can also consult a physician if you have specific health concerns regarding exercising. So our recommendation is men over 40 and women over 50 should consult with a physician before engaging in a routine exercise program. So now that we've talked about physical activity and exercise and all that fun stuff, what are the benefits of exercise? And we kind of touched on that, how it reduces the risk of disease, but it also reduces the risk, the feelings of depression and anxiety. It improves emotional health, it improves sleep, and it improves creativity and intellectual functioning. So, you know, there's a wide range of benefits to exercising, not just the long term, oh, it reduces the risk of, you know, heart disease and diabetes, but short term as well, the emotional wellness, the, you know, intellectual wellness that it confers upon people. I just want to make a quick note about feelings of depression and anxiety. You know, for when I say that it improves these feelings so that you're less likely to be depressed or feel depressed, that's for very mild cases. So, if you're generally kind of sad and then you exercise and you feel a little better, that's what I'm talking about. If you have clinical depression, that's completely different, and exercise alone isn't going to solve that problem. So for an instance like that, you would need to seek out medical care and probably would need to manage that condition with medication. Generally, psychological conditions, emotional illnesses or mental illnesses, it's not a matter of willpower. And sometimes the media likes to portray it as, oh, if you just, you know, think hard enough, then you'll be able to overcome your schizophrenia. That's not true. You need proper medical care and proper medication to manage these programs. You know, if you broke your arm, just, you know, wishing hard enough or, you know, looking past the pain isn't going to make your arm get better. You need to go to the hospital. So it's very similar to that, and it's important to kind of change our reference to psychological illness. But we'll have a whole lecture on psychological illnesses later on. So back to exercise. It also reduces the risk of premature death. Physically active people have a reduced risk of dying from every single cause. That doesn't include, you know, dying of stupidity, of course, but generally from every other cause that can cause someone to die early, you reduce your risk from exercising regularly. It reduces the risk factors for smoking, high blood pressure, obesity, and diabetes. So usually people who exercise will be less likely to smoke, they're less likely to have high blood pressure, less likely to be obese, and less likely to have diabetes. It also improves cardiorespiratory functioning, as we talked about a little bit earlier. It improves the function of the heart and the ability of the system to carry oxygen to body tissues. Exercise directly affects the health of your arteries, keeping them from stiffening or clogging with plaque, and reducing the risk of cardiovascular disease. You also get more efficient metabolism and improved cell health. So basically, this metabolism is the process by which the body converts food to energy. So people who exercise regularly or who are physically active will have an increased metabolism. So your body will be better able to convert your food into energy as opposed to someone who's sedentary. Regular exercise also helps prevent the deterioration of telomeres. So if you remember back to your bio class, telomeres are the little bits of DNA at the very end of the DNA strand, and they've been implicated in aging. So as we get older, the telomeres get shorter and shorter and shorter until the DNA itself starts to degrade. And they've related these two with, you know, aging. So our skin gets a little older, we get wrinkles, you know, our joints stiffen a little bit. So if you exercise regularly, the telomeres don't disintegrate as quickly, and, you know, you have a little bit more vitality, a little bit more of a skip in your step as you age. It also improves body composition. So regular exercise and physical activity can increase muscle mass, which helps losing fat. And it's also very important for disease prevention and management. So a lot of people, when they think of preventing disease or managing disease, they think of, you know, an infectious disease like the flu. Oh, you know, we can prevent getting the flu by washing our hands, which is true and good advice. But we also have to think about the long-term chronic diseases. Remember back a couple of lectures, most people in America today are dying from chronic diseases, not infectious diseases. And chronic diseases can be easier to control for. So physical activity helps reduce the risk of all these chronic diseases that we may encounter later on in life, the heart disease, the diabetes, the obesity, all those fun things. And as a fun side note, physical inactivity, so being physically inactive like Homer was in the clip that we just saw, can increase the risk of cardiovascular disease by 240%. So just being sedentary, just being physically inactive at unhealthy levels will increase your risk of cardiovascular disease by 240%. So get up and exercise, get up and move around. You know, every hour, stand up for a few minutes, stretch, you know, walk around wherever you are, and then sit back down and get back to work. And that's all that it really takes. Regular exercise and physical activity has also been shown to reduce cancer rates, has been shown to reduce osteoporosis, which is especially important in women, and it has been shown to reduce diabetes as well. It also improves psychological and emotional wellness. Like we talked about earlier, it can reduce anxiety and depression. It can actually be as effective as psychotherapy in treating mild to moderate cases of depression. So psychotherapy is as opposed to actually taking medication for your mental illness, you'd be like talking to a therapist or a psychologist. Generally, that is a better course of action for people with mild to moderate mental health issues that don't require medication. For people who do require medication, you know, talking it out isn't going to help. But for mild, moderate, physical activity really helps reduce that. As I said before, it improves sleep, it can help reduce stress, it enhances self-esteem and self-confidence. This is really important, and you know, when we look in the mirror, and we'll get into body shape and body views of our own bodies in a minute, but just by exercising regularly, we can kind of trick our brains into thinking we look better than maybe we really do. So we can help our own self-esteem. When we look in the mirror, looking in the mirror is very subjective experience. You know, every time you do, you may see something a little different, and you're probably going to see something you don't like. You know, everyone does that. But just exercising regularly will kind of reduce that. You'll look in the mirror, and you'll see someone who exercises, and you'll say, oh, I'm healthy. I look a little bit better. And you'll have a little bit higher self-esteem. You'll have a little bit higher self-confidence. Enhanced creativity and intellectual functioning. Improves work productivity. So, you know, if you're working in an office, if you're working at school, it can help, you know, with homework, it can help with studying habits, it can help getting your work done throughout the day. And it increases opportunities for social interaction. So you can go on a group hike together and you can meet new people and make new friends. You can go to the gym and meet new people and make new friends. It's like when Homer went to the gym and he met Rainier Wolfcastle. You know, he didn't have to talk to him, and Rainier Wolfcastle didn't have to come up to him and help him out, but, you know, they formed a friendship through exercise and physical activity. So Paige writes in, does too much exercise, for example, 7 days a week, several hours a day, without ever giving the body a rest, still decrease the risk of death? As you age, does the impact of exercise on metabolism remain the same or decrease? So for the first part of that question, exercising too much is actually pretty bad. You can actually be addicted to exercising. You can be addicted to a wide range of things, and exercise is one of them. So you want to be able to give your body a rest. If you don't rest, as Paige asked, then generally the health benefits will start to decrease, because your body has to rest at some point. And if it's not, if you're constantly pushing it, if you're constantly exercising more and more and more, over time, your overall health is going to deteriorate pretty substantially, and you can actually injure yourself. So you always want to take a break, but you also want to just slightly push your limits. So that's what I mean by pushing your limits. You know, you don't want to overdo it, but you want to do a little bit more than you did the day before, and, you know, without hurting yourself, without causing any severe pain. The second part of the question, as you age, does the impact of exercise on metabolism remain the same or decrease? Generally, as you age, the impact on metabolism will decrease, but that's mainly because as you age, you're just going to become more and more physically inactive. You know, once you get to around 40s to 50s, you're going to find that you're not going to be able to do the same things that you were easily able to do in your teens and 20s and 30s. And that's just a normal part of aging. So as we slow down, you know, just naturally as we slow down as we age, you know, the effects on our metabolism will decrease as well. You know, we may not be able to run 5 miles anymore because our knees will hurt, our joints will hurt. You may not be able to, you know, do 100 jumping jacks anymore because same reason, you know, your bones hurt, your joints hurt. You know, things are starting to wear down over a lifetime of use, which is perfectly normal. So that's another reason why you don't want to overdo exercise, because remember, foundation for later on in life, as you continue on, you know, things will wear out a little bit faster than maybe they should have. So moderate activity, give yourself a break, and as you age, you want to keep up activity level as high as you can without severely injuring yourself. So people will gain weight as they age, and that's perfectly natural. Some people won't, and that's perfectly natural too, but you know, you just want to keep a healthy level of physical activity for where you are in life and where you are in that activity level. Jocelyn writes a question. A few weeks ago, I saw a news story about the importance of physical activity for elementary kids. Why do schools place so much more emphasis on academics and not recognize the value of physical activity? That is a political reason, mainly. There are only so many hours in the school day. Generally, schools are 8 to 3, right? So that arose in the late 19th, early 20th century when everyone was still a farmer. So you get out at 3, go home, you can still work the farm for daylight. That's why we also have summer vacation, because you had to take a break from school to go home and help with the summer harvest. Obviously, that doesn't really make much sense anymore, where most of Americans live in cities and are not farmers. But the remnants of that policy still remain. So schools don't place such a importance on physical activity for one reason: the time constraints. There's just not enough time. Two is budgetary reasons, specifically in California, but this is in all the states. Budgets are tight, and you only have so much money for services. So you have to repair streets, you have to pay police officers, you have to pay firemen. You have to provide social services, you have to provide government services, and you have to provide education. So there's only so many dollars to go around, and generally schools are one of the first on the chopping block. So they may not have money for proper physical activity, proper equipment, proper teachers. And one of the last points is that the state and local school boards won't put as much emphasis on physical activity as they will on academics. Parents have a huge role in a child's academics, and a general rule of thumb for elementary, middle, and high school is if a parent calls in to complain, then something's going to change because they took the time out, they're complaining, they're the boss, things are going to happen. So over the years, as people have put so much emphasis on education, our kids have to be competitive, we have to compete with the Chinese and the Germans and whoever. They put everything focused on primary academics, and things like physical activity fall by the wayside, when in fact physical activity is just as important as math and reading and things like that. It's very difficult for people to wrap their heads around that idea, but basically it's a rich tapestry why schools don't. But they absolutely should, whether or not they're increasing the school day, whether or not they're cutting back on something else while increasing physical activity. It's just as important as any other subject. Suveria writes a question: is it true that people are born with a different metabolism? And if so, for people with a high metabolism level, does that also decrease as they become older, even if they've had it all their life? Yes, everyone's a little bit different. Some people have a high metabolism, some people have a lower metabolism, some people are somewhere near the average. Metabolism can increase with physical activity. So, if you were born with a low metabolism, you can increase that. You may not be able to increase that as high as some other people, but you can still increase it to a healthy level. And remember, it's not necessarily, I need to increase my metabolism, I need to increase my muscle build, I need to increase my strength. It's about living healthy. So if you do your 30 minutes of moderate to vigorous activity a day, if you're walking upstairs, if you're, exercising regularly, then you don't really need to worry about metabolism. Everything kind of will fall into place on its own. And as long as you're eating healthy, as long as you're exercising or moving around regularly, things will be fine. You may be a little heavier than you want, you may be a little skinnier than you want, but that's perfectly natural, and there's a wide range of human body shapes. But yes, metabolism will also decrease as you become older, even if you've had it all your life. That's just a natural part of aging. So we're going to take a break in a minute, but before I do, I want to quickly talk a couple of more points about exercise's benefits on health and wellness. You also get, for regular physical activity, you also get an improved immune function. So just moderate activity can improve immune function. Physically fit people have been found to get fewer colds, for the infectious side of things, and they'll also get fewer chronic diseases. Prevention of injuries and lower back pain. So physically active people will prevent injuries more than physically inactive people, and they'll prevent lower back pain. Generally, the injuries occur during everyday activity, so physically fit people or physically active people will be less likely to hurt themselves doing an everyday activity than non-physically fit people. Before we take our break, I'll talk about the two characteristics of the best exercise program. This might be on a test, so, and this is just good life advice as well. The best exercise programs are fun to do and they promote health. So, you know, it's not about going to the gym, it's not about bench pressing 500 pounds, it's about doing an activity regularly that you find fun and promotes your health. So if you love surfing, then that's physical activity, just go and surf, and that counts. If you love running, go run. If you love hiking, go hike. If you love, I don't know, bungee jumping, go bungee jumping. As long as it's fun to do, as long as you can do it regularly, and as long as it promotes health, then it's perfectly acceptable exercise, it's perfectly acceptable physical activity. So while we all think on that, let's take a quick 5-minute break. And, you know, get up, stretch, move around a little bit, and I'll see you when we get back.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to planetary science and astronomy class at California State University, Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California, not just the United States, but the world. And I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world, and to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
My name is Zenea Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
This is student life.
I'm home right now, but...
Go! Sweet!
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, welcome back. So we'll start off the next 20 minutes with a question. Jonah writes, how does exercise exactly improve sleep? Is it simply because physical activity makes you tired so that you fall asleep sooner? And yeah, that's actually part of it. You know, you're more active throughout the day, you get a little bit more tired and you'll fall asleep, more likely to fall asleep. There's also other psychological components to that as well. Inability to sleep does not necessarily mean you're not physically active, because there's plenty of physically active people who can't fall asleep. So remember, physical activity helps with psychological wellness and psychological health, which can in turn influence sleep patterns. So the more psychologically healthy we are, you know, if we're not so anxious, if we're not depressed, if we don't have some other mental illness, then you know, we can usually fall asleep a little bit sooner. So it's all a rich tapestry of interplaying concepts and ideas. But essentially, it's a little bit of that, yes, and a little bit of the psychological health. So back to exercise programs. Remember, they're supposed to be fun to do, and they're supposed to promote health. Those are the general rules of physical activity and exercise programs. Some of the basic principles of exercise routines are that they should be specific, progressive, you're supposed to rest, and they're supposed to be reversible. So what does that mean? Specific means that you must perform exercises designed for what you want to do. So if you want to increase your muscle mass or muscle strength, you should lift weights. If you want to increase cardio endurance, you should run. You know, if you want to build your abs, you should do sit-ups. Things of that nature. It should be specific. That reminded me of a point that I want to make that a lot of people who engage in physical activity don't do. Or they do, and it discourages them. We humans can't spot lose weight, or lose fat. So what that means is we can't do a bunch of sit-ups and then think our stomachs are gonna get smaller. Or we can't do a bunch of running exercises and think our thighs are gonna get thinner. That's not really how it works. You can't choose where you wanna lose fat from. Generally, as I said, fat is stored different places for men and women, but your fat will kind of decrease overall on a whole as you become more and more healthy. So unfortunately, we can't get six-pack abs if we have a bit of a belly because we're just doing sit-ups. That's just not how it works. The muscles will develop under the fat, and you'll have a six-pack under that, but the fat won't disappear without other regular physical activity that promotes overall health. So back to the basic principles. They should be progressive. So that means you start low and increase workload during the session. So, same as I was saying before, if you're walking or running, you start easy. You maybe walk a mile, maybe you run half a mile, and then you build up from there. Or if you're doing weight training, you start small. You do maybe 10 pounds, 15 pounds, if that's comfortable for you, and then you work up from there. Rest, so back to the question that we had a little earlier is, don't overtrain, don't overdo it, because this can lead to injury. Generally, what we like to say is you take a day off and then you start again. But this is for specific high intensity activity. So if you're weight training, you know, take a day off, let everything rest, and then go back to it again. And reversibility. So that means so a good exercise program is something that you're supposed to continue on essentially for the rest of your life. You know, physical activity should be, and healthy eating should be something you do forever. So reversibility means that if you stop exercising, then all your improvements will disappear. You'll lose them. Actually, you can lose up to half of any improvements you made in 2 months if you stop exercising. So this is a problem. This is one of my pet peeves with diets and, you know, fad diets and fad exercise diets and all these things. By definition, diets are temporary. So if we have in our mind, oh, we're gonna, you know, I need to lose 10 pounds, or oh, I just want to bulk up a little bit, you know, that's already by definition a temporary thing. So once you achieve your goal, or once you get close enough to your goal that you can stop, once you stop, in a couple of months, everything's going to go back to the way it was. And that not only has issues for your physiological health, but it also has issues for your psychological health as well. You know, you're going to look in the mirror and say, oh my God, I'm getting fatter. What happened to my muscles? Things are falling apart. When in fact, you probably shouldn't have been doing that to begin with. So slow, steady exercise, slow, steady physical activity over the intense long term. So over the next 20, 30 years, regular physical activity. And when it's put like that, it is very difficult for people to start. But you can't think of it necessarily in those terms, you know, one day at a time type deal. And eventually, over time, as you continue to do something, it's going to become habit. So if you continually eat healthy, eventually, over time, eating healthy will become your habit. And you'll do that without even thinking about it. If you exercise regularly, you know, over time, over a couple of months, it's going to become habit to exercise, and you're just going to do it without really thinking about it. So let's look at some examples, specific examples of exercises that you can do. So I'll go point by point for the different categories we had, and just, you know, say a couple of exercises that a lot of people like to do. So for cardio, generally you should start at about 3 days of cardio a week. Beginners start at 3 days, and you can work up to 5 days as time goes on. The intensity level should meet your target heart rate. So the range of rates for which you should exercise to obtain max benefits, that's your heart rate. And that's estimated from your age, so you'd have to actually look that up from a chart to see what your ideal heart rate should be, and then you exercise to meet that ideal heart rate. Your total time should be about 20 to 60 minutes per workout or per activity session. Can be done all together or spread out. So that's what I mean by, you know, if you don't have time to run around on a track or run around your neighborhood or even walk around your neighborhood, you know, you just take the stairs, you get up and stretch every so often. It doesn't have to be one clump together. It can be spread out throughout the day. So low intensity exercise should last about 45 to 60 minutes, moderate 20 to 30, different types of walking, jogging, swimming, you know, things like that. And you should prepare a warm-up and cool-down. So, you know, you stretch a little bit, you start walking, then you run, then you slow down, then you stretch, and then you're done. Alex writes in a question, is moderate or vigorous activity healthier for an athlete? It's not necessarily healthier by, you know, it won't confer any additional health benefits that they already don't have from being an athlete. But generally, you should exercise at your level. So beginners should exercise a little bit lower. So, you know, 20, 30 minutes a day, you know, any intermediate, you know, a little more. And then vigorous activity for an athlete is probably going to be the norm. That's what, you know, they're accustomed to. That's what would be a healthy level of activity for them. But remember, everyone's a little bit different. So while, you know, vigorous activity for an athlete isn't necessarily healthier, mild activity for a non-athlete isn't going to be any different. So it's all a matter of who you are, you know, what stage you're at, and, you know, you're exercising for your health, not for anyone else's health, not, you know, well, that guy can run 12 miles, why can't I? You're doing what you can do, and you're exercising for you. Then there's exercises for muscular strength. So there's various different types of muscular training. There's resistance training, which is muscles exerting a force against a significant amount of resistance. And this can be done with free weights or exercise machines. There's isometric exercises, which is applying force without movement. So this is actually pretty good for toning. An example of isometric would be standing up against a wall and then pushing against that wall. You're not moving anything, but you're still exerting a force. There's isotonic strength, muscular training, which is applying a force with movement, such as bench pressing. And this is good for developing strength. And then there's core exercises, which trains the midsection muscles, the butt, and the back. Essentially, this is all just like reaching, walking, jumping, twisting, squatting, throwing. Anything that moves the midsection around is essentially a good exercise. Quick note about muscle exercises. There are sex differences in the exercises we should undertake. So generally, men are going to start off at a baseline that's stronger than women, and that's just natural. But that doesn't mean women can't do the same thing men can do, and that doesn't mean women can actually surpass men in muscular strength. It's just everyone starts off a little bit differently. Everyone has a very different baseline. Most women won't develop large muscles, and large muscles are usually a side effect of testosterone, so women don't have much of any testosterone. So they're not really gonna develop as big of muscles as men can, but that's okay. Because, you know, you should be exercising for your health, not, you know, to be a bodybuilder. Unless that's what you want to be, then by all means. For choosing exercises for muscular training, you generally want to work all muscle groups. You want to start off easy. Be careful of overdoing it at first. You know, your body has a really great way of telling you when you're going to overdo it. So, you know, take it easy at first, work into things. Don't take supplements. They're not necessary unless you're an athlete and your trainer or your doctor says, oh, you probably need a little bit extra because your diet is not meeting your nutrition requirements. But generally, for the rest of us, we get everything we need from the food we eat. For flexibility exercises, it's important for maintaining normal range of motion. Exercising can be stretching. There's static stretching, there's dynamic stretching. A quick note, don't do ballistic stretching because that's actually very dangerous. And that's where when you stretch, you bounce back and forth a bit. It's a little difficult to describe, but if you're constantly like reaching stuff or bouncing or you're twisting weird, then that's actually really dangerous for you and you're not supposed to do it. For flexibility, you're supposed to steady, solid stretching. Frequency should be about 2 to 3 days a week, and intensity is about, time is about 30 minutes of mild to moderate intensity. For staying on track, it is very difficult for people to stay on track. So an awesome place to start is an exercise class. Like I was saying, you know, physical activity can confer a lot of other benefits besides just being healthier. And one of them is a social benefit. So, you know, you go to an exercise class, you can meet new people, you know, experience new things, you know, and it can just be a general fun way to exercise. Start slow and ease into it and be consistent. That's very important, is consistency. So you have to do this over the long term. No one can run around the block for a day and get healthy. So let's move into fat distribution on the body. We're going to start off with obesity rates. Now, obesity is actually a pretty big problem in America today. 35% of adults are overweight, and 33% of adults are obese. So altogether, 2/3 of the American adult population is either overweight or obese. That's 200 million people, and that's a lot of people. Health costs, medical costs associated with obesity are as much as $150 billion a year, and an obese or overweight person can expect to pay about $1,400 more a year for medical care costs than a healthy weighted person. And successful weight management, which we talked about earlier, is coordinating nutrition, physical activity, and stress control over the long term. So what does it mean to be obese? The textbook definition is that an adult who has a BMI of over 30 is considered obese. Someone who has a BMI of between 25 and 29.9 is considered overweight. So essentially, if you have a BMI of over 25, you're either overweight. If you have a BMI of over 30, you're obese. BMI is actually a very poor choice to measure body fat because muscle weighs more than fat. So a bodybuilder or someone with high muscle density will actually have a higher BMI. And if you go by the chart, then they'll be considered unhealthy, even though they may be perfectly healthy. So BMI is used in a lot of studies because it's very easy to do. It's based on your height and it's based on your weight, and you just plug it into a calculation and then you get your BMI. It's very simple to do, it's very cheap to do, it's very attractive for a lot of studies. So that's why a lot of newspapers, a lot of magazines, a lot of news shows will specifically focus on BMI. It's very cut and dry, it's very easy to understand, but it does have some serious problems. So the textbook definition of overweight would be total body weight above the recommended range for good health. And that, again, is based on height and age, and you get it from a chart. And obesity would be a more serious degree of overweight that carries multiple health risks. So the health risks, as we talked about, heart disease, cancer, kidney disease, skin problems, sleep problems, back pain, and arthritis. So we generally want to move away from the idea of, you know, thin is in, thin is good, to healthy is in, healthy is good. So you could be a little bit heavier than you want to be. You may be even a couple of pounds heavier than, you know, the medical book says you should be. But as long as you're exercising regularly, as long as your physical activity levels are high, as long as you're eating appropriately, then there's really nothing to worry about. So some of the other ways you can measure body weight aside from BMI is a skin fold measurement. So you basically just grab a bit of fat, like the picture behind me. You get a caliper, which is this little thing, and then you squeeze the fat and you measure the thickness of it. And you plug into a formula to get the body fat percentage. There you go, that's a caliper. Then there's a bioelectric impedance analysis, which is attaching electrodes to your body and a current is passed through it. The amount of resistance to the current is proportional to the amount of fat in the body. And then there's hydrostatic weighing. Basically, this is just putting someone in a tank of water and calculating the body fat from density. So people with more fat tend to float way less underwater than people with a moderate or lower amount of fat. So your body fat distribution, as I talked about a little earlier today, confers various health risks. So as I said, people with abdominal fat or greater than normal abdominal fat will have greater risks of, you know, heart disease and other chronic conditions. There's a risk factor. This is a risk factor independent of BMI. So you can actually have a fair amount of fat in your midsection or your abs and still have a healthy BMI. And just because you have a healthy BMI doesn't necessarily mean that you're at the right level. So you should go by, you know, what you see. If you have a little stomach on you, that's perfectly healthy, that's perfectly normal. But if you're getting to the point where it's getting bigger and bigger, and, you know, your BMI may not be going up, but it confers some pretty negative health risks. So you can the healthy abdomen fat should be, you get a measuring tape, you measure the circumference of your abs by placing a measuring tape on the top of your hip bone. So anything over 40 inches in diameter is unhealthy for men, and 35 inches is unhealthy for women. So we're almost out of time today, but I just want to quickly summarize, you know, physical activity and exercise have to be fun, and it doesn't have to be a specific workout. It doesn't have to mean going to the gym. It doesn't have to be, you know, using machines. It can be anything in the world that you like to do that you can continually do. So that's all for us today, and see you all next week.